Hi, everyone. My name is Jian Zhang. I'm a fourth-year PhD student from Stanford University. And today, I'm presenting YellowFin, an automatic hyperparameter tuning, a tuner for momentum stochastic gradient descent. And this is a joint work with Yannis from Mila, University of Montreal. So in the modern deep learning and machine learning system development, hyperparameter tuning is one of the key procedures to attain strong model performance. However, this procedure can be computationally or labor intensive. For example, for the recent language representation model BERT from Google or GPT from OpenAI, it can take up to 4 days on 16 GPUs, TPUs, or 1 month on 8 GPUs to train a single model with a single hyperparameter configuration. Thus, extensively tuning these models can take ages or tens of machines. So among the different type of hyperparameters for machine learning models, one of the hyperparameter for optimizers is usually the key to the strong model performance. The de facto approach to reduce the optimizer tuning labor is using the adaptive optimizers, such as the Adam optimizer. These optimizers typically tune individual learning rates for each variable, and they don't tune the momentum values. However, recently, researchers have seen that in many NLP or vision models, under hand tuning, momentum stochastic gradient descent with a single learning rate and momentum can actually attain strong or better generalization performance for both synchronous and asynchronous training setting. The natural question to ask here is that, can we automatically tune the momentum SGD hyperparameter so that we can achieve a similar performance as hand-tuned momentum SGD, and simultaneously, we can enjoy easier hyperparameter tuning? To answer this question, in this work, we proposed the YellowFin tuner to automatically tune hyperparameters for momentum SGD. And in this talk, I will show you that the YellowFin tuner can achieve competitive performance to hand-tuned momentum SGD in various type of models in our experiments. And we will also see the YellowFin tuner can achieve up to 3.28x convergence speed up comparing to hand-tuned Adam optimizer. And in the asynchronous setting, we will also see we can achieve up to 2.69x speed up than hand-tuned Adam optimizer for asynchronous training. So in this presentation, I will first go through the theoretical insights which inspires the design of YellowFin tuner. And after that, based on the theoretical insights, I will demonstrate how we can adapt the theoretical insights to design the tuning rule for momentum stochastic gradient descent. And at the end of the presentation, I will discuss a variant of YellowFin tuner specifically designed for asynchronous training to accelerate convergence. So to get started, I will demonstrate the theoretical insights which inspired the design of YellowFin tuner. And we'll be using a quadratic function as a running example for clarity. And using this example, I will first show you why and when momentum gradient descent can achieve better convergence performance than gradient descent without a momentum. And these theoretical insights will be shed light on how we design the YellowFin tuner. Now let's first look at a one-dimensional quadratic function. It is defined by the curvature h and the optimum point x star. And the curvature h here determines the width of the quadratic function. We would like to apply the standard gradient descent on top of the quadratic function, where we take step towards the negative gradient directions. And the convergence speed of gradient descent on the quadratic function is determined by a quantity called convergence rate, which is strongly determined by the learning rate alpha and the curvature h. At each individual step, the distance towards the optimal point will reduce or contract by a factor of rho. Thus, the smaller the convergence rate is, the faster gradient descent makes progresses in the optimization process. Now in this figure, we realize the convergence rate for the one-dimensional quadratic function with different learning rate. We can see in this example, if you are lucky enough, you smartly pick the optimal learning rate, you can achieve the convergence within a single step. However, what would happen if we have a high-dimensional quadratic function, for example, a three-dimensional quadratic function? To understand the behavior of gradient descent on the high-dimensional quadratic function, let's construct a 3D example with different curvatures along the different axes or directions. As shown in the left figure, the curvature is 1 along the blue axis with the slowest changing slope. And the curvature is 4 along the green axis where the slope changes the fastest. In the red figure, we plot out the convergence rate for gradient descent along the three different axes on this three-dimensional quadratic function. We can see with the same learning rate, it will demonstrate different convergence rate along the different directions. So as the overall convergence speed is determined by the slowest converging direction, the overall convergence rate is actually the maximum rate across the convergence rate of the different directions with different curvatures. The drawback here is that the convergence rate along the different directions are very unbalanced. They can never achieve the same value. And the worst or the slowest converging direction becomes the bottleneck. Actually, we found momentum gradient descent can help elevate this problem. In comparison to plane gradient descent, momentum gradient descent consider both the current gradient and the move in the last step. The influence of the last step is controlled by the hyperparameter beta, the momentum value, over the next step we want to make. And in this figure, again, we plot out the convergence rate along the different directions in the three-dimensional quadratic function achieved by momentum gradient descent. We can see that if we properly set the hyperparameter, we can achieve the same optimal convergence rate along the different directions with a different curvature value. Now let's take a comparison between gradient descent and momentum gradient descent. On the left-hand figure, we can see for gradient descent, we can never achieve the same convergence rate along the different directions with the different curvatures. And it is bottlenecked by the slowest converging direction. On the right-hand figure, we plot out the convergence rate for momentum gradient descent, where we can see if we properly set the hyperparameter, we can attain the same convergence rate along all the directions with the different curvatures. This same rate along different axes is important because it balances the convergence speed along the different directions. And if we properly set the learning rate and the momentum, we can achieve better convergence rate than the optimal convergence rate from gradient descent without momentum. Now the question is, under what condition can we achieve this same convergence rate along the different directions? Our analysis shows that we actually need to satisfy the following robustness condition. High level speaking, given the largest curvature and the smallest curvature in the quadratic function, we need to make sure the momentum value is large enough. And we also need to make sure the learning rate is within a specific range so that we can achieve the same convergence rate along different directions. To summarize in one sentence, if we want to achieve this same convergence rate for all the axes with different curvatures, we need to satisfy this robustness condition. And if we properly set the learning rate and the momentum, we would be able to achieve better convergence rate than gradient descent without momentum. So now we have demonstrated our insights on the convergence behavior of momentum gradient descent on quadratic functions. However, in the modern machine learning workloads, we use stochastic gradient descent instead of full batch gradient descent. Thus, in the next, I will demonstrate how we can adapt our theoretical insights to momentum stochastic gradient descent. So, the key difference in stochastic gradient descent is that we estimate the gradient with mini batch data stochastically, which introduces gradient variance. If the robustness condition is satisfied, the expectation of the model parameter will converge with the same convergence rate along different directions. However, the robustness condition only specifies a set of possible learning rate and momentum. Our question is, which specific value should we pick out from this set? And in our design of the YellowFin tuner, assume we are at the t-th step, and we select the learning rate and momentum by minimizing the expectation of a squared distance. This squared distance describes how far away you are from the optimal point in the next step. And we choose to minimize the distance in the next step because it can give us an efficient closed form solution so that we can efficiently update the learning rate and momentum in every iteration during the progress. So to apply the tuning rule to non-quadratic objectives, we can first measure the landscape and construct a local quadratic approximation of the landscape. And then we can tune the single learning rate and momentum at each step based on this local quadratic approximation. To evaluate the performance of the YellowFin tuner, we compare YellowFin tuner to hand-tuned atom optimizer and hand-tuned momentum stochastic gradient descent algorithm. Here we report the speed up in convergence in various different models. So in this table, we can observe YellowFin tuner can automatically achieve competitive or faster convergence than the hand-tuned momentum SGD algorithm or hand-tuned atom algorithms. For example, the YellowFin tuner can achieve up to 3.28x speed up over a hand-tuned atom optimizer in an LSTM model. And in these two exemplar figures, we also visualize the generalization performance for attained by each optimizer. If we take a vertical line on these plots, we can see the YellowFin tuner can also achieve competitive or better generalization performance than hand-tuned momentum SGD or hand-tuned atom optimizer. So now we have seen the YellowFin tuner can tune the learning rate and momentum to achieve competitive performance to hand-tuned stochastic gradient descent in our experiments. In the rest of the talk, I will briefly describe how we can adapt the YellowFin for asynchronous training. Here, the YellowFin tuner can naturally fit into the situation because recent research show that asynchronous training need additional tuning for momentum, and the YellowFin tuner can tune the momentum on the fly. So in a conventional distributed training setting, we use synchronous systems where we use a synchronization lock to synchronize the parameters on each workers. And on the other hand, for the asynchronous training setting, the system removed the synchronization lock so that the parameter server and the workers can communicate model parameters or gradient in an asynchronous way without waiting. Thus, this can improve the system throughput of the training system. However, because of the asynchronous communication, the parameter server can update the model parameter with out-of-date gradient values or the stale gradient values. This makes it requiring more iterations to achieve a specific convergence criteria. And recently, research shows that asynchrony in the system induces momentum. And asynchronous training needs more iterations, partially because the mismatch of the desired algorithmic momentum value and the effective total momentum value in the system. Or more concretely, if we explicitly give a momentum algorithmic momentum value to the system, the effective total momentum in the system would be a larger value. And because our YellowFin tuner tunes the learning rate and the momentum without explicitly consider this induced momentum. Thus, it can slow down the convergence speed of momentum stochastic gradient descent tuned by the YellowFin tuner. And our idea here is that we can automatically compensate for this induced momentum on the fly. So more concretely, we design a closed form control mechanism for the YellowFin tuner. Specifically, we can measure the total momentum in the system, and we can control the algorithmic momentum as the input to the system. We close this loop with a negative feedback mechanism, and our target is to match the total momentum to the target value desired by the YellowFin tuner. As shown in this example, without the closed loop control mechanism, we can see there's originally a gap between the total momentum in the system and the targeted momentum value. By using the YellowFin tuner with the closed loop control mechanism, we can see it automatically brings down the algorithm momentum as the input to the system. And quickly, it can match the total effective momentum to the targeted value desired by the basic YellowFin tuner. Indeed, as shown in this example, we can see the YellowFin tuner without the closed loop control mechanism will suffer from slow convergence. However, by adding this closed loop control mechanism, we can observe it significantly accelerates the YellowFin tuner in terms of convergence in the asynchronous training setting. So now, let me conclude the presentation. In this presentation, we discussed the YellowFin and automatic hyperparameter tuning, a tuner for momentum stochastic gradient descent. And to get the design of the YellowFin tuner, we have gone through the theoretical insights which guided our design of the YellowFin tuner. And we demonstrated how we can adapt our theoretical insights to design tuning rules for momentum stochastic gradient descent. And in the last part, we have also discussed a variant of the YellowFin tuner, which can accelerate the asynchronous training. That's all for today's presentation, and I'm happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Okay, so it's almost lunchtime, but I think we should pester Jian with a couple of questions. I think we have maybe three minutes or so.
Sure.
Hi, Elmadi from EPFL. I saw that you validate your theoretical insights on CIFAR 100, so I guess your loss function is non-convex. You're doing some deep learning, right?
Yep.
One problem when you take into account curvature between different workers is that not only you'll have state gradients, but you'd have different local curvatures at each worker. How did you handle that? The fact that workers are in different parts of the loss function where the local curvature is not the same.
Ah, okay, so basically...
Just before, since people are filtering out, the keynote's at 2 p.m., so everyone mark your calendars for that.
Yep. So basically, we consider a problem in the following way. So let's start from the synchronous setting, where you have a single, copy of the model parameter, and you have a single curvature description of your landscape. And in the asynchronous setting, actually, we consider the model parameters stored in the parameter server. Mm-hmm. That means actually we still have a single copy of the model parameter in the parameter server, and we actually consider measuring or approximate the landscape considering the model parameter stored in the parameter server. So in that sense, the model parameters there's only one copy. And we measure as usual as in the synchronous setting.
Okay, maybe we can
continue. Yeah, we can
think
out offline.
Also, for everyone in the back, can you please refrain from talking? The session's still going on. Out of respect for the speaker, thanks.
Hi, my name is Chandan, I'm from Intel.
Hey.
I have one question. So. Atom is essentially like a superset of momentum, right? So is there any reason you didn't consider applying this to Atom?
Yeah, so the question is that Atom optimizer also have a momentum hyperparameter. So any of the insights or approach we apply here can be applied to Atom optimizer. Yeah, so basically we have done some experiments on the momentum tuning side of things. For example, for the asynchronous experiments, it is generally true that no matter which optimizer you are using, if you have a momentum term, the total momentum is actually enlarged by the asynchrony in the system. And we have done some experiment that we also grid search the the momentum we use as the input to the system for atom optimizers. We have seen that tuning the momentum there is also relevant to the performance. So I think one of the key points can be applied to atom is that you also need to carefully tune the momentum for atom optimizer if you are considering an asynchronous stream setting.
Great. Thank you, John. Let's thank the speaker.
Thanks, Alex.